This website hasn't changed in 20 years, but hundreds of millions of people still use it every single month to post jobs, sell cars, and maybe even find a place to dump a body. Somehow, Craigslist still ranks in the top 100 of US websites, garnering more visitors than platforms like Spotify and Roblox. Craigslist generated an estimated $486 million in 2022 revenue, and it does it all with 50 employees. Now, to put that in context, that's $13.2 million per employee, which is more than 15 times what eBay makes per head. Craigslist's continued prosperity is puzzling in an industry that's always obsessed with a newer, faster, sexier thing. I'm gonna tell you how complacency actually kept Craigslist current. Let's dive in. To understand Craigslist, we need to understand Craig. Yes, Craig. Craig Newmark, that is. He's a nerdy guy known for his thick-rimmed glasses and a signature newsboy cap. Craig began his career as a programmer at IBM and worked there for 17 years. When he was recruited to work for Charles Schwab in San Francisco in 1993, Craig started an email newsletter to curate local events to foster community in SF's growing tech scene. When other people asked to join the list and contribute to its content, Craig went from SF newcomer to its ultimate tech insider. But then things got crazy. Submissions started to pour in for things completely unrelated to events, like, for example, job postings that targeted Craigslist's growing community of engineers.
Where Craigslist started was actually in the tech elite in San Francisco. And that is so different from the stereotype now where Craigslist, if you're looking on Craigslist for a job, you are looking for a job that's $20 an hour or under.
So out of pure generosity, Craig decided he should support this community with a greater effort. And we'll see throughout this video that generosity is a theme throughout Craig's life. Craigslist had expanded to 23 cities by 2003 and was pulling in 100 million monthly page views and $7 million in revenue. But wait a minute, where did all that money come from? With hundreds of millions of users, you'd think it would be advertising, right? Craig noted in a 2019 interview how he was thinking about ads, and he pretty much said that he found them to be annoying and dumb, and that he didn't want them to reduce the user experience of Craigslist. So instead of flooding Craigslist with promoted products, Craig decided just to charge people a small fee to make certain types of postings. And to this day, Craigslist only charges users for certain posts in certain categories. For example, selling a vehicle, apartment rentals, commercial real estate, and jobs. And that's about it. But telling you that Craig was alone in this master plan would be false. He stepped away from the CEO role early, and he brought on a guy named Jim Buckmaster. Craig recruited Jim to be the CEO of Craigslist in 2000, and he still runs the company to this day. In 2006, Jim was asked how Craigslist planned to maximize profit, and he shocked the audience when he said, that definitely is not part of the equation. It's just not part of the goal.
Craig Newmark and Jim Buckmaster, who are the company's two owners, are very iconoclastic. Craig has often said, I've got enough money, I don't need more. If they don't want to charge more and make more money, wow, that's well within their prerogative and good for their users.
But benevolent managers aren't the only reason Craigslist has remained the same throughout these years. And it's because the company never brought on venture capitalists who could impose profit-maximizing goals on the firm. I'm about to tell you, though, about a situation when that nearly happened. Even when eBay made a strategic investment in Craigslist, Craig stuck to his guns. eBay's investment ended in a lawsuit, the launch of its own competitor called Kijiji, and a 2015 divestment. Craig's philosophy just wasn't compatible with a big public company. And he always talks about how he never subscribed to the thinking that VCs and bankers tried to impose on him. In fact, he even said he wouldn't really even know what to do with $1 billion. But there are other people who were very interested in $1 billion. I'm currently driving today in Palo Alto, California on Sand Hill Road, which is where all the most iconic VC firms are headquartered. And it's here where countless founders came with an idea to disrupt Craigslist. And many of them got funding on this very street. People used to post ride shares and carpooling opportunities on Craigslist, and now they use Uber. People would post personal ads to meet dates and find the love of their life back before Hinge and Tinder existed. And when people had a couch free or a guest bedroom, they would post that to Craigslist, but now, obviously, they use Airbnb. And for job postings, I can't even name the number of companies that took some amount of market share from Craigslist's massive recruiting section. In fact, if you had invested in all of the startups that verticalized one of Craigslist's markets, you would be one of the most successful venture capitalists in history. But all those companies I just mentioned, they were focused on just one part of Craigslist. No competitor was ever able to copy the sheer breadth of Craigslist's local classified offerings. But then another nerdy guy entered the fray, and this one was much more interested in
$1 billion.
Zuckerberg is an expert in the art of copying, and Facebook Marketplace was no exception when it launched in 2016. It was a more modern version of Craigslist with a key differentiator: trust. Look, I know it's funny to put trust and Facebook in the same sentence, but you have to remember that Craigslist sellers are completely anonymous. On Facebook Marketplace, you can see who you're transacting with, and that matters for a lot of people because trust has always been Craigslist's weakness.
On April 10th, everything changed. The Craigslist killer began his 7-day crime spree.
There have been people attacked, kidnapped, and murdered off of Craigslist ads. In 2016, the Washington Post found 101 murders linked to the website. These safety concerns are a major reason why people have flocked to Facebook Marketplace. It's estimated that around 1 billion people use Facebook Marketplace now, and Craigslist traffic has certainly suffered as a result. Its web traffic is a third of what it was in 2017 and explains an estimated revenue slide of over $500 million.
Usage of Facebook Marketplace is huge. They're probably now larger in the US than Craigslist. We presume it's growing. Facebook is very, very opaque about Facebook Marketplace.
But Craigslist is not dead, not even close. People frequently post the same listing on Craigslist as well as Facebook Marketplace, while buyers routinely hunt both sites for their goods of choice. I'm the perfect example of this. A few months back, I helped sell my family's jet skis off Facebook Marketplace, and before that, I sold my car on Craigslist, and I posted them to both platforms because I wanted to maximize the odds of finding someone who really wanted them. And the dual platform approach, it worked. And for all the flack that Craigslist gets for its anonymity, it's actually been shown to be a positive in limiting the discrimination we've seen on other marketplaces like Airbnb.
But one of the things that I found when I was doing research on Craigslist, especially when you talk to people who have a particular interest in being, you know, maintaining privacy, so people of color, sex workers, people who are poor, those people actually really appreciated the anonymity of Craigslist because it meant that they didn't have to reveal information about themselves that they might not want to provide.
But I should mention that through all these times, Craigslist hasn't been completely complacent. The company rolled out a mobile app in 2019 and does make engineering improvements here and there. And even though Facebook Marketplace appears to be larger than Craigslist now in terms of traffic, it's far from perfect. A 2021 ProPublica investigation identified thousands of listings on Facebook Marketplace that broke the company's rules and linked 13 homicides to the service. The main point I want to make is that local classifieds isn't a winner-takes-all market. Clearly, there's a lot of flaws in the model, and there's a lot of messy stuff that can happen on these platforms. But clearly, this duopoly between Facebook Marketplace and Craigslist will persist for some time. As for Craig, remember that quote from earlier where he said he wouldn't know what to do with $1 billion? Well, it's clear he has some idea. The most recent estimate of Craig's net worth by Forbes put him at a whopping $1.3 billion in 2020. But in his generous spirit, Craig's been committed to giving it away. He pledged $100 million to both cybersecurity initiatives and veteran support. He's also passionate about journalism, having given over $170 million to the field since 2016. That included a $20 million gift to the City University of New York for the Craig Newmark Graduate School of Journalism. Craigslist is no doubt a fluke in tech history. There's a reason Blockbuster doesn't exist anymore. Companies that don't innovate die when disruptive startups do things better. But let's be real, guys. Is there really much better than Craigslist? I mean, even a company as well-heeled as Facebook wasn't able to solve the core issues that happen on local classified markets. There's nothing glamorous about buying or selling local goods in your neighborhood. AI, crypto, or the next big tech trend is never gonna change that. In a world where we're always tearing down the old and replacing it with the new, Craigslist is a reminder to us all that some things are better left unchanged.